King Herod had first taken the throne as a hated usurper, but after executing Mariamne, his wife and the legitimate heir to the throne, all pretense was lost. Herod's lifelong paranoia became justified, and the king buried himself in personal pleasures. He remarried several women. Not remarried several times, remarried several women at the same time. Within a decade of Mariamne's death, he had fathered 13 legitimate children. So many that I can't even show all of them on this chart. And frankly, that's okay, because only a few of them will end up mattering. Herod's severe depression worsened with age, but his moments of lucidity were consumed by a singular goal: to elevate Judea to the dignity of a great empire, every bit the equal of Rome and Egypt. South of Jerusalem, Herod built himself yet another massive palace, the Herodium, to serve as his eventual tomb. To the north, he massively expanded the shipyards at Straton's Tower into a new Roman-style city, Caesarea. Straton's Tower by this time had become Judea's main port, one of its largest cities, and one of the biggest shipyards in the Mediterranean, so the gesture wasn't lost on Emperor Augustus. But by far Herod's most ambitious effort was to transform the Jewish temple into one of the wonders of the world. Between 20 and 19 BCE, the Temple Mount was raised up to a massive platform roughly level with the foundation stone, giving the mount its modern appearance. Meanwhile, the temple sanctuary was renovated with marble and gold. Herod may not have been allowed into the temple like his Hasmonean predecessors, but no one could now claim that it was not his. However, Jerusalem still lacked one thing that every great city needed: a basilica, a grand hall of commerce, law, and civil administration. You may recall that because the temple could not accept foreign currency into its treasury for sacrificial donations, a currency exchange was established in the Court of the Gentiles, the outermost part of the temple complex, which served as a general marketplace for Jewish pilgrims. However, the true center of commerce in Jerusalem had for centuries been the Hellenistic market on Mount Zion, essentially as far from the temple as possible. The religious orthodoxy that kept foreign coins out of the temple treasury was the same which kept the commercial center off the Temple Mount. But in keeping with Roman city planning, Herod broke this division by commissioning the Royal Stoa, a massive 300-meter open-air basilica which would centralize all financial activity within the temple complex. I think it goes without saying that this was not the Jewish way. Something had to give. And at this point, we need to acknowledge that Persia exists. Although the Parthians were not ethnically Persian themselves, rather they were the ancestors of today's Kurds, they nevertheless considered their empire to be the successor to the empires of both Cyrus and Alexander, and accordingly enforced a strict policy of religious and cultural toleration under which the Jews of the East had thrived. Babylon had become a storied center of rabbinical teaching, but one Babylonian Jew wanted to learn Torah from the greats back in Jerusalem. Around the time of Pompey's Judean campaign, a man named Hillel came to Jerusalem to study under the Nasi Abtalion, but was too poor to afford admission to the yeshiva. So one night, he climbed onto the roof of the yeshiva and eavesdropped on the discussion until he passed out half buried in snow. The next morning, the rabbis found Hillel and brought him in, saving his life and allowing him to study. Eventually, Hillel rose through the ranks to become head of the Pharisees and replace Abtalion as Nasi of the Sanhedrin. Hillel was a strict moralist who favored the spirit of the law over the letter. One day, a Gentile who wished to convert to Judaism asked Hillel to teach him the entire Torah while he, the convert, stood on one foot. Hillel accepted and said only this: "What is hateful to you, do not do to your neighbor." That is the whole Torah. The rest is commentary. When the toadying Menachem the Essene resigned as Av Bet Din, the Pharisees effectively restored one-party rule. And as so often happens when a political party is so dominant that it spans the entire ideological spectrum, it splintered into two new factions: the moralist House of Hillel, and the legalist faction led by the new Av Bet Din, Rabbi Shammai. Whereas Hillel believed that the entire Torah could be reduced to the Golden Rule, Shammai believed it was a lifelong study that no man could ever truly complete. There are a whole bunch of stories about the debates between these two men, and I encourage you to look them up, but I'll share my favorite. Once, a student in the yeshiva asked the rabbis whether it was acceptable to tell a white lie, asking if it was right to tell an ugly bride that she was beautiful on her wedding day. Shammai told the student that lying was always wrong, even to spare someone's feelings, because even brutal honesty has grace. Hillel responded, "All brides are beautiful on their wedding day." But despite their clashing philosophies, the two men could still agree on one thing. King Herod had to be stopped. And opportunity knocked when a bunch of men from Egypt came to them with a problem. See, back during the war between Octavian and Antony, a bunch of Jewish women in Alexandria had been raped by invading Roman soldiers and became pregnant, eventually giving birth to these men right here. Since their fathers weren't Jewish, it wasn't clear whether they were Jewish because they couldn't inherit the title of a clan. But they had been raised as Jews by their mothers, and thus couldn't integrate into Egyptian society. Hillel realized that this was probably happening all over the empire, and convinced the Sanhedrin to pass a new law declaring that Jewish identity was matrilineal, passed down through the mother. The decision was also a political protest. King Herod, as the son of a Jewish father and an Arab mother, was not technically illegitimate because the Sanhedrin rulings weren't retroactive, but the message was clear enough. It also meant that Herod's sons by Princess Mariamne now had a stronger claim to the throne than he did. Mariamne's sons were already much more popular than he was, and most in Judea looked forward to one of them replacing Herod as king in the near future. Herod became convinced that his sons were conspiring against him with the Sanhedrin. And in fairness, Hillel and Shammai were using the Sanhedrin to conspire to assassinate the king. But it wasn't clear that the two princes were in on it. But in his rage, Herod had his sons, the heirs to the throne, executed for treason. Over the next 2 years, Herod went even further by hunting down and assassinating almost all the remaining heirs to the Hasmonean dynasty, including many children. But the prince's children were mysteriously spared. Alexander's eldest son Tigranes later served as king of Armenia. Aristobulus's 5 children, most notably 4-year-old Agrippa and 8-year-old Herodias, were even sent to Rome to be raised in the imperial court. This isn't relevant to anything right now, but just remember that they're there. Ironically, the one son who definitely did plot to kill Herod was his eldest, the exiled Prince Antipater from his earlier marriage. Antipater was caught, turned over to Emperor Augustus for sentencing, and was executed in the winter of 4 BCE. Herod himself died that April from an unknown illness, probably a combination of kidney failure and genital gangrene, which lasted over a month and was so painful that he attempted to commit suicide. But lest you feel too sorry for him, Herod was well aware of how hated he was, and began to worry that no one would be sad when he died. So he ordered several members of the Sanhedrin to be assassinated so that, even in death, he could take credit for the grief experienced by their widows and orphans. Thankfully, this order was recognized for the atrocity that it was, and was never carried out. Herod was a paranoid, murderous tyrant and usurper who bankrupted Judea in a hopeless attempt to gain recognition as a great leader on par with Caesar or Cleopatra. Ironically, his singular obsessions with palace intrigue and personal glory were arguably his saving grace. Had he directed his fury against the great Sanhedrin, it likely would have destroyed the kingdom. Instead, his violent criminality largely healed the rift between Judea's political factions by uniting them against him. That in turn kept the Sanhedrin powerful enough to vote against his interests, endorse conspiracies against his life, and declare his rule all but illegitimate with impunity. Unfortunately, Herod's obsession with palace intrigue did ensure that he would die without a clear successor. And it was this that would ultimately lead to the demise of the Jewish state. Special thanks to my patrons, including Gaonit level patron Vicky Nelson. If you like this video, you can also donate via Patreon link below. You can also check out my book, An Armada of Cats Travels in Israel, along with links to my sources for this video. Otherwise, you can always like, share, and subscribe. I will see you next time.